Welcome back, teams, to Michigan's Ri3D. Today we have Krishna and Arnav talking about our software and coding. Krishna and Arnav.
Yeah, sure. So we're going to start with each subsystem. So we'll start with the drivetrain here.
Sounds great.
For the drivetrain, we included code for both tank drive and arcade drive because we know like there's a variety of different drivers on your teams. We want to code for both. You know, if drivers have to switch, if something happens, we want everyone to be comfortable with how they're driving and stuff like that. So we have arcade and tank drive. We also included a few different like drive modes, like slower, faster. And our main drive mode is actually using a squared function, which allows for like more accurate driving when you're driving slower, but then when you're faster, it doesn't really matter type of thing. So that's kind of what we did for the drivetrain. There's two motors on each side. We made motor control groups and worked from there. I'll pass on to you.
Arnav.
Sure. Next, I'd like to talk about the vision system. Our system right now is a Logitech webcam that's plugged into the RoboRio. And for a while, we tried to detect April tags using this webcam, but unfortunately, there were some issues with libraries and dependencies that we weren't able to resolve. But you know, it's very early into the season. I'm sure that those issues will be mitigated as the season progresses. If we were building a whole robot for a full season, we would likely be using Limelights or a more complicated vision system that can localize the position of our robot based on the 8 April tags and a couple retroreflective tape positioned around the field. Next we'll move on to the arm.
Great, the arm.
Yeah, so the arm subsystem's a little bit more complicated. So as you know, we don't have any encoders on a robot, which is kind of a little bit of an issue. But in order to work around that, we have to take a few extra steps. So we have one command that basically moves the arm out, up like this. We have one that brings it back down, like that. And then there's two commands that actually hold it in place. So at lower angles, maybe from like down here to here-ish, we kind of have to apply a low amount of power to keep the arm up in this state instead of falling back down due to gravity, right? And the same thing is true when the arm's upright up here. So we have two buttons on our controllers that allow for the arm to keep its position depending on where it is. We apply a different amount of power to kind of keep it upright. And this, with an encoder, this is much easier. You can kind of create a function with the encoder value and multiply that by some constants to figure out what power you need on this motor right here to figure out, basically, I want to keep it in this position, move it forward, backward. And there's a lot more you can do in that sense. But in our 3 days, we had a few makeshift solutions. And if you look at our code, which is all on the FAM GitHub, you'll be able to see how we implemented this. And now to the grabber arm.
The intake, as we like to call it. It's pretty simple mechanically, as we mentioned in the other video. It's just one motor. And again, we don't have any encoders on this robot, so it's very simple to code. We just applied some power to open it, and then as long as the button is held, it'll stay open. And then when we want to close it, it'll initially close like this, and then apply some power constantly for there to be some force on the intake so that the held game piece doesn't fall down. And
here's a game piece now. Perfect.
So it'll swing like this, and then the motor will apply some power to keep the game piece in place. And then when we're over the goals, we can just let go, and it'll fall onto the goals and score points.
Wonderful. Is there anything else that we wanted to talk about? What do you think we would have done if we had more time and more resources to put into this, at least from a software perspective?
So as I mentioned earlier, with the vision system, we would like to improve that to get accurate positioning and possibly also control, so that instead of having to manually align yourself either horizontally or distance-wise to the goal, you'd be able to detect the distance to the goal and automatically move the robot to the desired distance, which is not actually terribly difficult, but you would need to have a working vision system and probably encoders on the drivetrain if you want to talk more about that.
Wonderful.
Yeah, another main point, if you'd hold this, that we really thought about is a NavX on the robot, right? We didn't have a NavX available to us, but they're actually, we looked into it, and you know, they're not too expensive, about $106 is what I saw most recently. But
what exactly is a NavX?
It'll tell you a lot about your robot. It's kind of like a gyroscope. It gives you information about what angle your robot's at, kind of the speed you're moving at, position, a lot of other things like that. You can look more into it. But mainly for the autonomous mode, specifically balancing on that scale is where it comes into use. So with the NavX, you're able to find out what degree that or plane that your robot is on. So if you mount it flat, you can mount it in any way, actually, and it would figure this out. But through some calibration. But if you're on the ramp, you'll see that you're at about an 11 to 15 degree incline, depending on where you are. And then when you're on the top, you would be obviously flat 0 degrees. And by using that, you can actually figure out where to drive up to and where to stop on the incline during autonomous mode and get those, I believe it's, is it 11 points?
During autonomous, I think it's 12 points.
12 points, okay.
For being docked or docked, and it's when it's level. I don't remember the exact. Check the rule book for precise terminology, teams.
Oh yeah, engage. That's the word.
Engage. Dock and engage.
Thank you.
Thank you.
But yeah, so you know, NavX is really useful in this case. You know, there are maybe some computer vision solutions to this problem, which you could see in our other videos. But NavX is really important. I think NavX encoders, limit switches, a lot of those sensors that we didn't have are really the gateway. Which we need to make our robot much more, I guess, sound in terms of code if we had more time.
Let's talk a little bit more about Auton. What exactly do we have planned with this robot, and where do you think we would have gone if we had more time and perhaps some of those more resources that we just mentioned?
Yes, of course. So with this robot, you know, we're a little bit limited. So I think the plan is we're going to score at least one cube or cone in the bottom level scoring area, which would be 3 points, I believe, during Auton.
Yes, 3 points.
And then we want to drive up towards the ramp. It's a little bit difficult to get it balanced, especially with no NavX. Mm-hmm. So we're expecting 8 points for it being on the ramp, but maybe not balanced, which would give us a total of 11 points during Auton.
Fantastic.
I believe in yesterday's stream, we talked about the scoring a little bit more in depth.
It may have been the day before.
Maybe the day
I don't
before.
Quite recall.
But yes.
Not to date ourselves on camera. Exactly when
That's
this
true.
Was filmed.
One of the days we talked about that. Please check that out. But you know, there's a lot of interesting things we could do if we had more time, as you were saying. Mm-hmm. With the NavX, we could easily and encoders on this arm.
Of course.
We could easily score onto the far goal with a cone,
which
or
would get us 6 points instead
six
of that
points,
three.
And we would be able to balance on the scale,
which would give us 12 instead of 8.
Exactly.
Getting us to a total of 18 points.
Which is pretty big, especially in the pregame section.
Or we could even look to try and score additional pieces if we were trying to get really, really fancy, of course.
Exactly. If we had some encoders on the drivetrain, we'd be able to know our position exactly on the field at all times. So we would be able to take a more complicated path than perhaps just straight forward and backwards. Mm-hmm. We might be able to go around, exit the community, and earn some points for that as well.
Mm-hmm.
We could grab another piece, maybe score it, and then go back to the charge station ramp, which is not really possible without encoders.
Yeah, and we wouldn't even need computer vision for that because the game pieces will be in a fixed location and we will be able to predetermine which game piece we're trying to pick up as well.
Exactly, although computer vision would help you to maybe reduce your error.
Yes, of course.
Or help align yourself with the goal if you're trying to score a second piece.
Of course. Great. Well, is there anything that we missed, guys? Anything that we're thinking of that we haven't covered with software?
If you want to check out all our code, it's on github.com/fam.
Wonderful.
Feel free to use it as a resource, but don't try not to copy it wholesale.
Absolutely. Resource and a guide. Do better than we did. Good luck, teams.